The yeas are 213 and the nays are 209, with six answering present. The resolution adopted. Without objection, the motion to consider is laid on the table.
So you can obviously hear the chanting by Democrats of shame as Kevin McCarthy finalizes the censuring of Adam Schiff last month. That is, of course, a video of the Democrats standing up for their colleague. It's also a demonstration of what Kevin McCarthy has become. He's dreamed his entire life, 80, 90 years of becoming the Speaker of the House. And now he just has to do whatever the craziest people in the country tell him to do. And as that was going on, it actually got even more heated and more personal, as you'll see in this video.
I will begin again. By its adoption of House Resolution 521, the House has resolved that the House of Representatives censures Adam Schiff.
That is Representative Swalwell yelling that he is weak. He is pathetic for the reasons that we've already said. Kevin McCarthy does not of himself want to do this. He has to do this, either because it's been demanded by the radicals in his caucus, or because, well, you know, I guess Marjorie was censured, so now we just have to start censuring people in the same way that, because Trump was impeached, now we have to impeach Joe Biden. The Democrats always have to suffer the mirror image of the sins of Republicans before them. But that was not actually the end of it. They continue to interrupt Swalwell and Kevin McCarthy. According to reports, McCarthy was visibly upset with Swalwell. Quote, he had a vein popping out of his forehead. Apparently, McCarthy stared down Swalwell for about 10 seconds before walking away. And that could have been the end of it, but it was not. The next day, actually, Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi visited Capitol Hill for a joint address. And before Modi took the speaker's podium, Swalwell was once again on the House floor, making his way to a bathroom when he was suddenly confronted by Kevin McCarthy. McCarthy said, "If you ever say something like that to me again, I'm gonna kick the S out of you," according to another member of Congress. You can define that for yourself. Another member of witness exchange said they were in each other's faces, basically nose to nose. And Swalwell said something like, "Are we really gonna do this?" This is like an exact replica of a scene from Cobra Kai. But anyway, they're full grown men, they're members of Congress. McCarthy issues a challenge, "Call me a P again and I'll kick your A." Now, both members told nearly identical versions of the story. They both delivered Swalwell's response in exactly the same way. "You are a P." Damn, gonna thrown down. But apparently Kevin McCarthy just stared at him for a while and then walked away. So look, I know that there might be an inclination to just have fun with this. I wanna start with the substance. If they were to fight, Swalwell would definitely kick his butt, right? Come on, am I just in a bubble? But I look at Kevin McCarthy and he is clearly one of the weakest human beings in the world. No?
Yeah, I guess Swalwell would win, but like,
I really want you to bet me.
Okay, I don't care at all. I don't
care. My money's on Swalwell.
Okay, yeah, and
he's gonna win. And the other thing about it is he'd win on the passion side too, because what is McCarthy really? He wouldn't even know what he's fighting for. But I wouldn't mind at this point. They've got to release this energy, go MMA style. One of the Paul brothers could train him. And just let's get it over with if this is what we're doing. You know, because I don't know what movie you named. You know, I don't really watch a lot of movies. To me, it was more Marlo and Kenya on The Real Housewives of Atlanta kind of situation. They hit below the belt and do this kind of dirty thing. But no business is getting done there, okay? Yeah. No business is getting done. Yeah. They got to get it on MMA style.
Okay. Well, we'll find out if there's the rumors are true that he swole well. Okay, seriously though, look, to Sharon's point, all this censuring and expunging the impeachments and impeaching Joe Biden for having the name Joe Biden, they're just all totally useless semantics, theatrics, etc. And why do they do that? For a couple of reasons. Now I'm talking about Republicans, I'll get Democrats in a second. They do it to satisfy their base. Oh, don't worry, we hate Joe Biden. We're gonna impeach him. And you guys have already shown, we don't need any evidence. You guys hate evidence. If we showed evidence, you'd probably go boo us, boo, right? So do we have evidence that Joe Biden did anything wrong? Of course not, we don't need it. Do we have evidence that Adam Schiff did anything wrong? No, but we call him Shifty Schiff or whatever. So okay, we're gonna censure him. Yeah, go ahead, who cares? Who cares, it doesn't matter at all, right? So I'm not like, some Democrats are like, oh, can you believe they censured him? Who cares? This is all just like third grade nonsense. The only thing I care about is, are you helping the American people or aren't you? And we're not anywhere near helping the American people. The Republicans don't want to. And the second reason the Republicans do it is, yeah, their base loves it, and they don't want to pass any laws that help the American people. So if they didn't do this, they'd literally be doing nothing. So they're like, oh, I got a great idea. Let's just insult the Democrats all day long, and that way that'll distract our base, and they won't notice that we haven't helped them 1%. We haven't even tried to help them. We haven't proposed a single thing that would help them. Brazenly, right? Okay, so that's that. And then in terms of the Democrats, that's why I wanted to do this story. So I think there's something fantastic in this story, and we've got more examples coming up in a second. But I've been covering politics for, unfortunately, now 25 years, right? Maybe even longer than that. And I've never seen the Democrats fight, like ever. So this is an incredibly welcome development, if you ask me. And I'm gonna tell you why I think they're doing it. But for 98% of the time I've been covering politics, Republicans will slap a Democrat across the face, proverbially, rhetorically, politically, ideologically, and sometimes physically. And the Democrats are like, oh, thank you, sir, may I have another? I'm so civil, I'm the most civil person, did I win? Oh, they're like, meanwhile, they're bleeding out and stuff. And then the Republicans will stand over them and go, I'm gonna sit there and bleed all day. And they go, oh, yes I am. So the fact that they're fighting back, what? It's a new day in America. Like, Democrats haven't fought in at least a quarter of a century, but it might be now 40, 50 years since they've ever fought a Republican.
Yeah.
So that's a great development. And by the way, why are they doing it? For two reasons. One, I think that they're human and actually had enough of the Republicans being so extreme and just insulting them in every insane way. And before they used to be like, well, these are our allies, these are our friends, and we want the Republican Party to be stronger because we're about to cut a corporate deal with them in a second while you're not looking. But now they're not even cutting those deals. And all the Republicans are doing is just eviscerating them in the most disgusting way. So they reach a little bit of a limit. So that's partly it. Then there's a tiny aspect of it that some of these folks are Justice Democrats, not Swalwell, but Cori Bush and some of the others, and they're not funded by corporations. So they're like, wait, I don't get it. Why are we letting them hit us over and over again? And the reason that there is a reason for that, because if the Democrats ever tried to fight back, their corporate donors would be like, don't you dare, okay? You have to work with those guys to give me tax cuts. And they're like, yes, sir, right away, sir, right? But now the biggest reason why they're fighting back, because they notice, oh, when you fight back, it gets in the news. And then I raise a lot more money from the grassroots. It's always the money, Lebowski.
Yeah, I mean, Schiff raised like over $1 million, I think, immediately after he was censured.
100%.
Yeah.
Swalwell, that's why, you know who's leaking these stories? The Democrats are. Like the Democrats are like, oh yeah, did you hear? Did you hear? Swalwell called him a P word, you know what I'm saying? Like he's weak, you know that one. And they're like, wait, that's not a word you guys use anymore, right? And they're like, who cares? Tell the grassroots, we're gonna raise some money. But I'll take it, I'll take Democrats fighting back under any circumstance.
Yeah, 100%. Look, they still obviously, including Schiff and them, they raised tons of money from corporations, as we've said, but now they have at least the hypothetical ability to raise money directly from people. That is now an option when you do this sort of thing, when you fight. They can potentially do that, and so it's more of a financial incentive. They used to just run on bipartisanship and unity and all of that nonsense that they really care about and most people don't. But now there's another option, and there's a dark side to that. If it's inspiring needless conflict between individuals, and obviously we see, you know, what the Lauren Boberts and the Marjorie Greens do to raise money, it's absolutely despicable. But yes, it is good to see them fighting back for once.
Yeah, 100%. And so look, we're running out of time, so I'll just tell you, Cori Bush yelled out that Steve Scalise was a racist in the middle of Congress as he was presenting their plans to cut the budget. And she's got some good reason to say that. They're gratuitously like ending a Latino museum just because they want to say we hate Latinos. They're trying to take a diversity, equity, inclusion out, etc. I don't think that was the most productive way for Cory to do it or Congresswoman Bush to do it. But I like that they're fighting back. And then Mark Pocan called the Republicans a bigot when they were discussing specifically the issue of how they put an anti-LGBTQ provisions in the funding bills. And I thought that was productive because it was in the context of that conversation. And they had that coming for a long, long time. And I'm glad that he pushed back on that and he gave specific examples. He backed up what he was saying. So I like that one a lot. So, but overall the tenor is we've had enough and we're actually going to counterpunch. And I am thrilled with that development. Sharon.
I am too. I think if you have to be on this never ending reality show unwillingly, then you've got to, you don't have to become them, but you do have to implore some of the tactics. I'm looking online, I'll buy the t-shirt, you are a B. If he's selling it, I'll buy that t-shirt because there has to be some pushback and you have to get on your toes and not be on your heels all the time. And you don't have to, again, become what the other side is, but you do have to, Bob, we adjust. And yeah. I think that that's exactly what's going on here, somewhat.
Hey everyone, as you all know, coronavirus has been pretty devastating for people's personal finances. The inaction in Congress or the very little relief that was provided by Congress, unfortunately, didn't do much to help small businesses that were really, really hurt by being forced to shut down in order to slow the spread of coronavirus. There are 100,000 small businesses that have been closed since the pandemic began. Some of you might feel helpless, but luckily there's this wonderful initiative known as the COVID Rescue Fund. So all you need to do is go to covidrescuefund.org and you'll learn more about how you can donate or how you can vote and promote your favorite small business. And really the whole point here is to offer generous grants to help these small businesses. The COVID Rescue Fund crowdsources up to $100,000 for each individual grant. So we're not talking about a small amount of money. You know, I've seen small businesses in my community shut down, and these are small businesses where I had relationships with the owners, and to watch them lose everything that they've worked so hard for has been absolutely heartbreaking. I really wanted to do something then, and I'm happy to see that there's an initiative that could help people get involved now. Go to covidrescuefund.org and donate. Let's come together and bring back as many small businesses as possible.